geoholic.
They're coming fast and furious, buddy.
I mean, we're in the hot seat right now.
Hope my voice will hold out. This has been amazing.
I'm sure it'll be fine.
Absolutely.
But we are joined by a couple guys.
Really excited to have this conversation with these
familiar
guys.
Company, new people.
For sure, for sure. Let's do quick self-introductions. Aaron, why don't you go first? Just name who you're with and kind of what you do.
Sure. I'm Aaron Newby, the Director of Sales for the Americas with Emesent. We are a LiDAR company, a pretty unique product because we have full autonomy on drones and completely modular. Yep. So use it anywhere. It's pretty awesome.
That is very cool. And do you live in Australia?
I do not. The name tag lies. I'm actually based in Phoenix, Arizona, but we have our U.S. headquarters or America's headquarters here in Denver.
So you do know that we are in Phoenix, don't you?
I did not know that.
You did not know that?
How have we not
How
met?
Have we not met? That I is mean, amazing.
Could have been in studio.
I know. I missed we'll the open this week, and I was kind of upset about that, but I'm happy to be here.
Yeah, for sure. Well, we'll hook up in Phoenix for sure. Definitely. Matt.
Hey, I'm jealous that you all live down there in sunny Phoenix.
You can move there too.
Yeah, Freefly is based out of Woodinville, Washington, just right outside of Seattle. So
okay.
Nice and rainy. We get lots of fun testing up there, though. So my name is Matt Isenbarger, Chief Revenue Officer at Freefly Systems. Freefly has been around for over a decade, making all sorts of technology products, but specifically drones, gimbals, cameras, and all of the fun accessories that go along with them. Quickly dominated the cinema industry and the heavy lift market, and we have since really focused on this industrial and commercial applications of surveying and mapping. And super excited to talk about our new partnership with Emesent today.
So cool. Yeah, we're excited to hear about it. I'm very curious. It's hard to keep up with technology because it advances so rapidly. So your aircraft, talk about like the most robust one. Like what is the payload now? What is the flight time?
So we have two aircraft right now, the Ultee X, which can carry 35 pounds of payload, and Astro, which can carry 3.5 pounds of payload. And, you know, we do a ton of testing. We document all that testing on our website and really are known for that reliability and the Freefly System brand.
Awesome. Awesome. So, Aaron, talk about the partnership a little bit and what it means to your company.
Sure. It's a big deal for us. One, because the Chinese drone manufacturers, they're getting kicked out. There are so many industries where they're no longer available to be used, and having a blue drone partner is big for us. The second real benefit for us is the capability for full autonomy, collision avoidance on their system, and the full integration.
Yep.
It took a long time to get to this point to basically enable the hover map to take over the aircraft and fly it beyond visual line of sight. You touch a button, hit go, and it just flies off on its own and does a job, comes back. You won't even see it. You won't even hear it. You just cross your fingers and it comes back every time.
Is it like at least a 98% success rate?
I can't say that.
That's so funny. Right? So what does it mean to your company?
It's incredible. Adding this type of autonomy to Astro opens up whole new worlds for us. So most drones rely on GPS to navigate and understand where they are in the world, but adding the hover map removes that need. So we can fly under bridges, in tunnels, underground mines, you know, in the most challenging environments out there without GPS. And you have full autonomy to not run into anything. And
how does that work?
It's the Emesent payload.
I mean, come on. If he told you, he'd have to kill you.
It's the Emesent payload. They've got a LiDAR that's spinning around 360 degrees, and it's scanning its entire environment to understand where all those objects are around your aircraft and keep you from avoiding running into them.
That's amazing. So you don't even need GPS.
That's right.
It's like an autonomous vehicle.
Absolutely.
Same type thing.
Completely autonomous.
Like Waymo.
Yes.
Yeah. What do you think of Waymo?
I see it every day.
And yeah. You're from our area.
It's very concerning.
Yeah. Have you taken one yet?
No. I have a car.
Sean's a big fan.
I'm a big fan.
Yeah.
I've taken quite a bit. But I have a lot. I haven't seen as much as you have, so I have some trust that you probably don't have because you know how the sausage is made, so to speak.
Seen behind the curtain.
Right.
That's funny. So talk about, you mentioned it briefly, maybe a couple of use cases for the different hardwares.
Sure. Emesent was born in the mines. Yep. So we were initially purpose-built to get into the deepest, darkest places where you cannot send a human being. So essentially, you know, you want to be able to safely scan areas drop it in, set a waypoint, have it go do its thing, and come back. Since then, we've expanded into several different use cases. Like you said, bridge scanning is huge for us. Typically, they would use a terrestrial scanner, shut the bridge down, have people on top for 45 minutes, an hour. Now you can fly one side, fly underneath, fly the other side with full confidence that you're not going to run into anything that you can't see. We are gaining forestry. Oil and gas is big for us too. Getting underneath the rigs safely where you can't send people is a huge benefit.
That's awesome. That's awesome. So it's almost like, for lack of a better term, the sky's the limit. It's just like how creative you can be for these different applications.
True.
Right?
Yeah. Well, doesn't it more get into all the things that you thought you couldn't do before?
You can.
Now are available, right? And like you never thought that you can get up and in, up and under the bridge. I mean, where do you think, I guess my question is, so you already identified a whole bunch of areas that you didn't have access to before. Where do you think you're at as far as that timeline? Are you halfway in where there's still a lot more use cases that you haven't discovered yet? Or where do you think you're at in that evolution?
Yeah, there truly are. Every client that buys one, they buy it for a specific purpose. And what we hear is, we started using it over here, doing this one job. Then other people in the organization see it. They want to use it. They want us to come on site and do different jobs. So it expands exponentially once it gets in their hands because they take it off the drone. They walk around with it. They put it on a car. They use RTK. They use 360 camera. They have so many different options with it that it really just explodes into these different use cases.
Yeah. So interesting. So do your clients typically come to you with a problem and then you figure out a solution? Is that a typical workflow or? Yeah.
Yeah, that's a lot of it. Yeah. And, adding the Emesent hover map to the Freefly Astro really opens up those capabilities especially to customers who may have been, nervous or afraid to fly in those very challenging environments, right? It just gives them that vote of confidence that this thing is going to work. And even in these difficult, nooks and crannies and the undersides of the bridge where photogrammetry and a regular camera would fail and just too dark to see what's going on in there, the lighter shines.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you have any where you said you set a waypoint and it just goes? What if you can't set that, like, as far as true exploration where you haven't even navigated to? Is that...
That happens all the time. There's a lot of mines that haven't been explored in years. They want to go back in there and figure out what they have.
Yeah, so you couldn't tell it, hey, go over here, because you don't even know where there is, right?
Yeah, exactly. But you can set a virtual waypoint. Just set a waypoint out there. The hover map will take off on the free fly. It'll explore the area on its own. It'll try to get there. It has built-in AI. So it'll go one way, go another way. And if it gets to the waypoint, it'll do a scan, come home. And if it finally gives up and says, I just can't make it, it'll come home as well, automatically.
Freaking crazy.
I know, right?
I don't even know what to think about that. So what else?
All right, so you got all this figured out. Now what's next and what else are you? I mean, are you still in all the different ways that we can use this, or what's the next? Is it smaller and lighter or more points and more data? What direction do you guys see yourselves going?
Yeah, the sky's the limit. I think you guys hit the nail on the head there, that the applications are endless, and as folks start to use it, they come up with new applications every day, and because they have the trust and the reliability and that it's just going to work and not run into anything, they're coming up with those ideas of how to solve their own problems. So, there's all sorts of issues with GPS all over the world going on right now with geopolitical things too. So even your above ground, kind of typical flight, there's, encountering issues with GPS right now. So having to not rely on that sensor, it's all sorts of new applications coming there that we haven't thought of as well.
Yeah, no doubt. Question for you. How has the hover map evolved, like from the first generation to the current generation?
Sure.
Oh, yeah.
So we, the initial unit, heavily robust. The newer units are all IP65. They have long range radio on them now. So if we do need to do some very, very long scans, we can get a kilometer and a half away and still maintain that connectivity. Freefly has the capability to eliminate the long-range radio because we're actually using their controller to communicate with the hover map and fly it at longer distances. So it gives us capabilities that we've never had before, which is another great reason we have this partnership.
So cool.
Yeah, I mean, there's just so many jobs that are dangerous and impossible to reach places. And so having this, being able to put this sensor in new and challenging environments, and getting up on those really high, hard to reach places, adds all sorts of value for these customers.
Yep. Add value, make friends.
Yeah.
We say it all the time.
That's what we do here.
And you can pull it off the drone as well and use it handheld, right?
Yeah, right.
And,
yeah.
And stick it on other vehicles as well. So, I mean, the applications for the hover map are really really endless. And with a lot of the traditional LiDARs out there, they just point and face one direction. So you're really only scanning in one specific direction where the hover map spins around. And so you're getting 360 degree That's coverage. Awesome. So those all those nooks and crannies and those really hard to create 3D models, the hover map just knocks them out.
Yep. Yep. Well, I got to say, you guys obviously very excited about this partnership. You've done a fantastic job promoting it. What else? What are you guys excited about?
We're excited to hear how customers use it. You know, we're just getting them out there right now for our first customers, and so we can't wait to hear their feedback and see all the fun applications that they put them into. There's been a ton of rain in California recently, and so the Department of Transportation down there is dealing with over 800 landslides right now. And so trying to get those roads back open and traffic flowing again, as you can imagine, is a challenge to say the least.
Yeah.
And so, you know, that's just one application that I'm super excited to see, you know, how customers put this to use and help everybody, you know, across that state and others to get back to their daily lives.
Yep. Yep. Well said.
It's Aaron, really cool.
You got the last word, my friend.
Oh boy. Here we go. I will say this, that, you know, I've been with Emesent for 2 years now, and the growth and capabilities of the company, everything is done internally. So all of our research development, ideas, we listen to our clients, we listen to our partners, and everything we do is purpose-driven for specific use cases, and we really care about what we do. And a partnership like this kind of speaks volumes about where we want to be in the future.
I love it. This is a feel-good conversation.
It really is. It's like one of those collaborations that, like, they both are working. Like, like, it's a win-win.
Like peanut butter and jelly.
Win-win, and everyone benefits.
Yes, exactly. Well, hey, thank you, guys. It's been great. Really appreciate your time.
Appreciate it.
Great to meet you.
Have enjoyed the show.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Here we are.
We're back again.
This might be a record for single day interviews.
No, maybe.
It's going to approach it.
I think by the end of the day, we
it's
might
only 2 o'clock.
Buddy. Oh, okay.
Wow. We got 2 more hours.
It's flying by.
Yeah, for sure. All right. Another
familiar guest and a new one.
Yep. And looking forward to having this conversation with both of these guys.
Absolutely.
Quick introductions. Why don't you just name who you're with? Obviously, we know. And what you do. And why don't you go first?
Yeah, sure. Hi, Stefan.
That voice sounds familiar.
You've heard me once or twice before.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. OG.
Co-founder and chief strategy officer at Emesent, and we developed the hover map product.
Right on.
All right. Hi, ahead, I'm Mike Russalesi. I'm the co-founder of SiteScout 360, and we use the hover map.
Okay.
I got to know more.
This is good. I have not heard of SiteScout 360, so I'm really excited to tell us all about it.
Great. So we're a service provider to go out and collect data for the as-built world. We started this about 2 years ago, understanding that when I would watch some folks go out and do standard measurements with their engineering and design teams, there was 5 people on site. And they were then writing it down with their hands. And I was like, what is that? That doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah.
We have 20 years doing software, right? And so we were able to start collecting data with LiDAR, with the mobile LiDAR. And it turned into recognizing that it's about a 98% efficiency to do it this way versus the old way. And we were able to collect multitudes more data in a weekend than an entire team to do it for 16 days straight, right? Yeah. So we ultimately said that makes sense as a business. We should probably look into this. So we were able to do that, and it turned into a really neat situation for us to start out. And then the hover map kind of came into play as an option that actually started my business. We got one, and we're like, oh, we should do this now.
Yeah, that's awesome. And what has this partnership meant to Emesent then?
I mean, obviously, having customers that are out there using the product and giving us feedback and pushing the limits helps us to develop, you know, new features and make the product better. So it's been awesome having the sites guys being out there. And you'll hear some of the crazy and innovative things they've done and how it's helped us learn and yeah. sort of build that into our product roadmap.
Awesome. Tell us about some of the crazy things you've done with it.
So we invented what we call Rolly. Rolly is a rig in which we walk around with our hover map. And the reason why we did that is because we're very focused on ergonomics, right? Okay. So to go out and do a space like this is 93 to 95,000 square feet. That's going to be 20 minute walks to do it. And just holding a hover map, or, you know, you'll see a lot of people around here walking around and holding. It's not tenable if you want to scale up a business around it, right? So we ended up saying, we need to do something. So I had a garage, and I spent a lot of time in my garage figuring out the problems of putting a hover map into a rolling situation that allows us to have a consistent way of collecting this data. And turns out that it's also adorable looking. And people
see. Did you model it after like SpongeBob or something?
No, but it does have googly eyes, although the googly eyes right now are in the dogs. I've handed that over.
We said it's roly, not squarey.
It's not squarey. It's exactly the opposite of SpongeBob. It's SpongeBob round pants.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know if that makes it any.
It does.
So by doing this, we had to overcome a few hurdles, because when we're doing indoor space with HoverMap, it's not built for that. It's built for mines. It's built for flying on drones. So it's pointing its camera down.
Okay.
And that doesn't really help me if I need to colorize points on a wall or on a ceiling. So we always have to angle it up. And walking with it angled up so that I can get that colorization, because colorization is important to us on our AEC stuff, it turns out that it was really, really hard to do that. And so it took 5 different marks for us to get it to where it is today. And it turns out that it is an absolutely, vital piece to making it work. And while we were doing it, we're like, oh, we're also adding a 360 camera on top. And we brought the 360 camera last year and showed you guys Rolly, because we didn't see you the year before because of COVID. But then we saw everybody last year, and you saw Rolly. Pictures abound with the adorable rolling Emesent hover map. And since then, we've been talking about this 360 stuff with them for a couple of years now, saying, hey, we're using it because the 360 video is a really, really important, non-technical deliverable we give.
Okay.
Because what we do is we go collect the data, and then we deliver a 360 video, the point cloud, and a Revit model. It's really simple.
Yeah.
And we do it all on HoverMap. And now HoverMap's putting the 360 directly in, so we can colorize eventually. Point cloud's off of the 360 video, so I don't necessarily have to make all of the concessions I did 2 or 3 years ago. So now it's more of a traditional data collect.
Interesting. So I just noticed your hat. I'm assuming that's Rolly.
That is Rolly 1, yes.
Rolly 1. That's great. Do you have a Rolly here?
Rolly is here.
All right.
Rolly always makes the trip. Yeah, absolutely.
Sure. Yeah. So what did you think about Rolly the first time you saw it?
No, like I said, it was great to see the innovation. I mean, we hadn't thought about doing something like that to see a customer. Yeah. Obviously, if you're scanning huge areas, you're not one carrying this thing around sort of in your hand. And like you said, the consistency. So having something that's mounted in a way that's capturing data consistently.
Yep.
And they were, so like you said, they bolted on a pano camera capturing video separately, and they managed to do their own job of stitching or time syncing the video to our LiDAR data. And we've had the same feedback from many others, like with HoverMap, it's great, but great to have panoramic images or 360 video. So that's what we've gone and done, is taken their feedback, and that's what we've launched basically at the show today, this week, is our panoramic image add-on.
Oh, really?
So
So is that incorporated into the hover map? How do
it's a like most of our hover map accessories, it's an add-on optional thing. So it's basically a GoPro Hero Max on a extending pole that mounts very neatly to the hover map handle.
Yeah.
So you capture the GoPro data, 360 data, hover map data, and then our software automatically syncs it up.
That's awesome.
Exports the pano images, georeferenced to the point cloud, and that goes into third-party tools like Pointera and into Bentley. And you can view the pano images and the point clouds together. Not yet colorizing the point cloud with the 360, but that's going to be released in the next couple of months. So,
Yep. So back to capturing the 360 video as you're scanning, and then you had to like, and you could probably relate to this.
Sure.
How did you line that up? I mean, was it easy or is it?
So our first attempt at this was really interesting. We're not doing anything where we're like, it's like, oh, I can reveal. And, you know, we started with that concept and that went away kind of quick. Because it's hard. If you're not going to do it, you know, and to be honest, we're actually doing some work with some SBIR stuff, so some innovation research money to do something like this for some under-peer stuff where we have our 360 camera happening.
Yeah.
And what happens is if you have separate 360 video from wherever your hover map is, it may or may not be in the same position all the time. And because we're using Insta360, it has its stabilization effect, and it has its own IMU, and it can drift on its own. So what we ended up finding was that it's much better just to simplify for the people who are going to be our customers who are going to receive this data. We ultimately just make a plan view that has a timestamp of a trajectory. And it says, oh, yeah, here, about a minute 10, we're walking around this corner. If that's what you want to look at, scrub to there. Right? So our goal is to keep it so we're not giving our customers anything hard to do, right?
Interesting. Well, because then your customers are primarily in the AEC space, right? Like they're the civil guy or the architect not necessarily they know what to do with a point cloud, but they don't need the whole damn thing and have to navigate through it, right? I mean, you're trying to get them to the exactly what they need in that one spot.
Well, let's be honest, no one knows what to do with a point cloud, all right? So,
right.
There's only 1% of 1% of people who can look at a point cloud and actually make something of it.
Sure.
I think they're all here today.
Yes, they are all here.
So let's hope nothing goes bad. But ultimately, our focus is like we have the data, which is over here. We have a customer over here who has no idea what it is. We're the center of the bow tie, right? We just want to make sure that we take all this crazy stuff that's over here and make it, you know, digestible for other people over here who just don't really generally see this. Our goal here is to just inform that this exists also. I mean, geospatial world, the outside world, drones, all of that stuff, that's becoming the norm. People get it now. Inside is wild. It's before the Wild West. It's ridiculous. There's nothing attacking it and it's all, it doesn't matter where it is. It could be here or Belgium or Tokyo.
Sure.
Inside space is inside space.
Yep.
It's a huge, huge opportunity, right? So that's why we're like, okay, well, let's scale this, but make sure that we can work with tools, and HoverMap gives us that opportunity because the slam that comes out of it, the point clouds are almost readable by normal people,
right?
Because they're really, really good. When we do the 360, we're not trying to overwork that, you know? We went down a path of trying to overlay it in Unreal and do fun stuff like that. And yeah, that's fun. And I want to do more of it, but it doesn't pay.
Yeah.
So
right.
we come back to how simple can we do this so that we can do it 100 times. And that's what we come up with.
Interesting. So you talked about, you know, point clouds. Obviously, we can collect more data than ever
now
between point clouds, 360 video, 360 imagery. How are people managing these large data sets?
So HoverMap helps with that tremendously, right? So by default, the output that comes from that is already pretty lean for what we're talking about. In fact, you know, we just had a customer come to us and say, hey, we just did a scan. I can't use this data. My computer does not open this. And we said, well, I bet you for the amount of money that it would cost to get me to do this same thing and the amount of time that it would take, I'm going to save you money, even though you'll collect it twice.
Right. Yeah.
You know, so.
Well, if you can't do anything with it, we can't do it, you know.
Well, we did that too. Someone gave us a 3,000 square foot space with a P8, and it had a billion points. And it took more time for us to bring that down to 10% of points than it took us to model it. And I'm just like, the economies of scale don't really make sense. So when we get it from output from HoverMap, I can predict that, you know, a 20-minute walk is going to be 2 gigs, right?
Right.
And 2 gigs, you can dump that into any situation. And, you know, Stefan was saying the different outputs that they support. I just use Poetry for my stuff too, right? So, and it works great, you know? So the concept of so much data, we're trying to minimize that as well, because the customer doesn't want to deal with that either. And, you know, what are you going to do? Have them download 20 gigabytes of data?
Well, yeah. Do you spend your time educating your customer on what they actually need and why? Or is it, this is, you know, you actually don't want 100 gigs. You only need one.
To be honest, what we tell them is that point clouds are auditable.
Okay.
All right. So if you want to verify that what we just did and modeled is real, open the point cloud, take a look at it. Other than that, don't touch it.
Right.
Right. You're just going to get yourself mired in this like crazy like spiral of Alice in Wonderland, and you're not going to know what's going on. Right. So we try to minimize that piece, and we just say, hey, look, here is your output. Your output is three things, simple. Focus your efforts on the 360 video to make sure that you have a sight view of the entire thing. And then when we give you your models from our HoverMap point clouds, understand this is the tolerance we're modeling to. You know, we're not going to be doing ridiculous millimeter we don't do that. And we say, you guys use Revit, so I don't have to invent Revit for them.
Right.
You guys can watch a 360 video on every computer ever and your iPhone and whatever. It's just not even an add-on, right? And the point cloud, if you can, use it as an audit.
Okay. Yeah, well, you gotta have some kind of QC here, right? Or some kind of, you know, they're gonna trust it, but what is it? The trust but verify. Like you're gonna pull it in and then go and okay, let's just take a couple. I mean, I see that. That makes sense. Hmm.
Yeah, definitely. Another great partnership.
Yeah, it seems like you
guys must be really good to work with.
Are really, really lining up the partnerships here.
Yeah.
Oh, well, we can't do it all ourselves, so it definitely makes sense to team up. And yeah, no, it's great.
Humble as well. I like it.
Can't do it all ourselves yet.
What else are you guys excited about?
So overall, Stefan alluded to it, but we've got just the integration of the 360 stuff, right? So
sure.
We've had to deal with, you know, managing our own 360 outside of this. But as we start identifying these different opportunities, we're bringing it back to the team, right? So we have, I want to say, at least monthly conversations with their software team. And us being a 20-year software company and then coming into this space, we love adding stuff to their backlog. It is a fun idea that we have some level of influence over what's going on there. And I have backlog items that are now just being completed from 4 years ago. But it's awesome.
Yeah.
You know, and that's one reason why we really like working with these guys, is that we understand that, you know, we're being heard.
Yep.
That's a really big thing. And it takes time to build software.
Right. Yeah.
And I'm not the most, like, I'm not sitting here saying, please do my stuff right now. I'm just saying, I hope that what we help you guys with, you know, brings, you know, more people to the platform, because we want to make sure that everyone understands that the differences of this platform versus all the other ones and why they're good. All of the other ones are good. There's reasons for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said before, this whole space that we're talking about, there could be 4,000 of us, and we're not even gonna make a dent. It is that big, right? So we're just lucky to be at Emesent, because Stefan and I were talking earlier. Phase one of this whole thing of like mobile data collect was, can we do it?
Right.
to the point where we're doing it. We're doing it really well, right? Phase two is bringing in that sensor integration, bringing in the outside stuff,
yep. Right?
Making sure that we can do some things. Because data collect, everyone's going to be data collecting. Yay. Making all of that usable is going to be like the next big thing.
For sure.
Yeah, and that's what I was thinking. It seems like that means you're, in a sense, you're giving less because the less size and the less you're giving you, the more usable it is.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
All right, Stefan, you got the last word, my friend.
You asked what else is exciting. I mean, obviously working with these guys is great, and I do want to tie that into one other thing that we've been another partnership, and that's our partnership with Pointera. So it's another great Australian company that's obviously got a global presence. So talking about 360 images, obviously we're getting to the point where we can export the images in the point clouds, but then you need a viewer to view those together and to manage the data. So Pointera is one example of a partner we've worked with, and now our HoverMap data goes seamlessly into the Pointera cloud platform, so you can view your images and your LiDAR data side by side. And we've generated a couple of standard outputs for other platforms as well. And we're making it easy for anybody else to be able to ingest our kind of data.
Hey, congratulations. This is awesome.
Yeah, it really is.
Yeah.
It's really impressive what you guys are doing over there. So.
Yeah. Thank you guys for your time. I'm good seeing you again, of course. Mike, great to meet you.
Great to meet you guys.
Yeah, appreciate you guys stopping by. Enjoy the rest of the show.
Well, thanks so much.
Thanks.
All right.
Cheers.
Take her out. She's humming up, she's ready now. And no one ever showed her how. This is mom. Got it going on.
Yeah, she does.
Thanks. They wanted Waka music. They got Waka music.
That's what you get here at the Geoholics.
You ask for music, you get it.
Love it.
Oh, man. Feeling good.
Yeah, had a nice little lunch.
Good lunch.
Got a little hit a little second wind action here.
I think I'm feeling pretty good.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah, I was a little shaky most of the morning. Too much to drink last night.
But, it's the altitude.
Yeah, it's the altitude.
That's what I'll tell my wife anyways. Yeah, for sure. But anyways, looking forward to this conversation. Got some really cool technology to talk about. Quick self-introductions. Nathan, why don't you go first? Just who you are, who you're with, and what you do.
Yep. My name is Nathan Pugh. I'm a CTO for Virtual Technology Simplified, and I've been involved in the business for a couple of years now. So I'm on part-time consulting, and then I came on board full-time this year with them. So.
Exciting. And John?
Yeah, I'm John Chwalibog. I'm the CEO and founder of VTS, or Virtual Technology Simplified. We started in 2017.
Okay.
We have been focusing on 3D reality capture services, and out of that developed some new technologies to kind of expand the toolbox for capturing.
So I got to understand, the name is Virtual Technology Simplified.
What does it make you think about? I can tell you what it makes me think about. I'm looking at the red easy button in front of me, like boom.
Yeah, I'm thinking something that has very few buttons, and is like something I would give to my grandmother if she would need to
keep it simple, stupid.
Yes,
I love it.
Yeah,
someone got it. No, exactly. You know, through the technology, we use the services to learn, you know, problems and, you know, what how do you capture things and why do you capture things. And, you know, the whole idea behind the app is this concept of crew sourcing. We wanted to put an app in the hands of people already on site, make it very easy for them to capture. Basically, if you can take a picture or a video, you can do 3D capture. But you kind of script the workflow a little bit. And that easy button idea is an awesome, kind of visual of it. I appreciate you gravitating to that.
It's mobile device friendly. Is that, I mean, it's designed for mobile devices, right?
Designed right now for Apple device.
Apple device.
Yeah, okay. Apple device only with the LiDAR sensor in it. So we're leveraging LiDAR and photogrammetry in the collection and processing and the reconstruction.
Okay.
That's mainly the iOS device has like that tech stack and the LiDAR piece and like the cameras that are known and things like that. So where Androids are a little bit all over the place depending which manufacturer.
Sure,
Got it. So tell us more. How is this improving people's lives?
Well, improving people's lives, It's a good question. Really, the whole concept enabling capture at scale, right? People that are already on these sites. When we talk about critical infrastructure, it's typically things that are hard to access. It's hard to get onto a power station subsite, a telecom site, you know, those kinds of things. And so this idea of crowdsourcing, using the public to capture things, is not really a solution to it. So it was more leveraging existing workforce, telecom workforce, maintenance operations people that are already visiting these sites. If after the work they perform, they could just pull out the phone, right? It's in their pocket, and capture quickly and feed data into the ecosystem.
So how is your app different than some of the other apps out there?
Yeah, Nathan can probably go into it a little bit more detail.
Come on, Nathan, as on the spot here,
as the CTO. Yeah.
So the I think there's two aspects to the way that we're looking at the app. There's the technology piece on the 3D reconstruction and using the LiDAR and the photogrammetry piece, which is one aspect of the capture. I mean, we still have to do work where we're using other terrestrial scanners or mobile scanners or drones and things like that. A big thing that we wanted to focus on is the work management piece of it, is how you get people to the site and where are they. Yeah, you know, there's a lot of reasons things can go wrong. You have to revisit a site, and we want to be one and done. So it could be, you know, site access, it could be control codes or like lockbox codes, it could be the info for the site contact, it could be weather, wrong equipment, equipment failures, and there's all these things that could add up basically that we'd have to go and repeat visit the site. And as soon as we do that, kind of from a services side of things, your margins obviously get a lot slimmer, right? So we wanted to do the work capture piece, but then have this scripted so, hey guys, when you're on site, there's no way you can screw this up, right? Here's what you need to collect, and some of it's photo documentation, and then the 3D documentation kind of adds context to it around the spatial environment. And some of it can just be equipment asset tags and things like that that can be taken with just images. So there's still a lot of images on, could be pre-engineering documentation or post-closeout work, post-closeout documentation, and how do we make it easy for them to basically use it. So that's, I think, the work management portion and how that runs into having capture crews and having people on site. That's probably one of the big differences between what you would get of like a, you know, if you go search like 3D scanning on the App Store now, right? There's like 25 apps or something, right?
Sure. So I think to add to that a little bit too, on the 3D reconstruction side, a lot of the apps that are out there are focused on app, right? And processing on app. We've partnered up with EveryPoint, David Boardman and the EveryPoint team. We're using their processing engine, and it's combining that LiDAR information and photogrammetry. So we're actually capturing it, sending it to the cloud, processing it. And that gives us a lot of flexibility in how the data gets processed and the resolution that we can output. So depending on the asset type, we can process it differently to get the output that a user actually needs, as opposed to kind of, you know, one result and trying to apply it for everything.
So on that note, do you guys customize it for the individual user?
The individual user can customize it themselves.
Oh, they can do it themselves.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So depending on what they're capturing, the type of asset, they can script it out in a way that makes sense for, say, a telecom tower site versus a rooftop site versus an underground manhole, you know, whatever that is. So it's customizable by the user themselves.
Well, and the one point, like, so where our default processing is at 10 millimeters resolution, we can take the same data that we captured, process it at 1 millimeter resolution. Takes longer, file sizes are way bigger, etc. But you can take the same data and get higher resolution or lower resolution if you want it quicker.
So who are your typical clients?
We're really targeting what we lump together is critical infrastructure. So telco, telecom, wireless, and wired. Naturally, there's kind of an extension into wired broadband, and then that gets you into power, utility poles. You know, it's really those asset types that we're focused on. And it goes back to this idea that typically these things are hard to access.
Mm-hmm.
Getting on to a substation site, you have to have special training. You know, a telco site, RF training, safety. You know, traditionally towers, climbers, right now drones, you know, so it's just, it's these things that are hard to maybe access in the kind of critical infrastructure world.
Yeah. So what was your background that helped you come up with this idea?
Yeah. How did you get here exactly?
That's a really good
question. It's a good story, though.
Yeah. I mean, Nathan and I have known each other since 2000. We worked together at Trimble. Been on the technology manufacturer side. So I spent a number of years at Trimble, Faro, and Matterport, kind of in this whole 3D documentation space on that side of it. And just got this harebrained idea we could do it differently. And so we just figured we'd branch out. I'm 54 now, and if I don't do it now, I'm never going to do it again. So figured, why not roll the dice?
Well, I think on the services side, when they were doing services, they kind of looked at their whole operations, and they were using like 12 to 15 different pieces of software, right? From this crew scheduling to data processing to data capture. And it's like, there's got to be a better way than just continually switching and going from this piece of software to this piece of software. And so it's kind of born out of a need for our own operations and being our own first customer for the product.
Got it. So, like, speaking of that need, what's the best or the best example of a user case that you've got so far? Like, what do you think it really captures exactly of a user case that
is making full use of it?
You think embodies exactly what you were going after?
Yeah, I mean, we've got a few different interesting applications. We're obviously using it in the telecom space and have partner companies that have come along there as well.
So I'm clear, like, it's the tower that's up on the hill, and you got to go through the lock gate and take a four-wheeler all the way up there. And the one guy that does that once a year, you might as well get some sort of some mapping or something while he's up there, some 3D imagery. So no one else has to send a separate crew to do that. Is that kind of the gist there?
Yeah, I mean, that's the gist of it. In the telco ecosystem, you got tower owners, you got the carriers, you got the engineering companies. There's all these different entities that, for whatever reason, need to understand the space. None of them share that information, and all have a need to acquire it. So they either hire someone to go do that, or they do it themselves.
And specifically within the U.S., like, the tower owners are basically leasing companies or real estate companies. It's like a landlord of a strip mall, right? Yeah. And they just lease space on this. So a carrier like T-Mobile wants to upgrade their network to 5G in the space. They have to go and figure out, well, what's on this tower? Because we have no idea. Even though our equipment's there, we don't know what the tower leasing companies agreed to and put on. So it's really like a documentation of the as-built before they can do any engineering design or design the equipment that they need to put on the site.
So on that, you know, once a year, someone might go out and do the capture. We talk about a drone and a phone.
Yeah.
So I go out and document it for you as an example, and I got a complete documentation. But if that Verizon worker goes out and replaces something, why not take the phone out of his pocket and scan what he did, right? The area that he worked in, and then update the digital twin with the new information.
Okay. Right?
So it's enabling capture at scale on an ongoing basis of smaller bits and pieces of it as it relates to the whole asset.
And does it take advantage of the GPS in the phone as well? Like, does it utilize that for, like, geolocating these pictures or whatever?
Yeah, you'll know where you are. And, I mean, typically you don't need to know within centimeter level where the tower is. If I know where I have a lat and long, I know where the tower is going to be, right? We do some stuff around more precise geolocation if it's required for tying into control and things of that nature. But typically, if you're within a few feet of a lat and long of a tower, you know where it is. They're not hard to find.
Well, you mentioned as-builting, and I guess the thing that just jumped in my mind is a common problem in as-built is during construction. And, okay, the surveyors or whoever wasn't out there to capture that before it's buried. Is that something like an application that you can have the field guys, you know, like you mentioned a manhole example, snapping some pictures and getting some data before it's backfilled and then patching that in and having a better idea of what depths and dimensions are at that scale?
If he says yes, you might have a new customer.
I was going to say to you, absolutely. We were saying, why not the backhoe operator?
Yeah, I mean,
right? I mean, it doesn't have to be a survey.
Anytime a buried utility is exposed, right, you might as well get an as-built because a lot of times, like, especially in the urban environments, remember, like, City of Toronto, all their utility designs were from the 50s, and they're only the design files. They don't have any as-builts, and so they'll dig up, like, a street corner. It's like, well, hey, nothing's here. And then they actually installed on the other side of the street, but they have no updated records on that.
Well, that's I know that sounds antiquated. That is currently happening today. Yeah. As in, they dug up that, they fixed it. No one got a shot on it. And now someone like Kent is asked for, hey, give me an as-built survey of that thing that we put in and buried and no one ever saw.
Yeah, no, that's exactly that use case. And that whole idea about crew sourcing is enabling the people on site already with a device they're very familiar with and just get them to do the capture for you.
So I got to ask, but the question is, what would it take for a surveyor to get the confidence in the measurement from what the guy in the backhoe is snapping? Talk to me a little bit about how that.
Yeah, like, so we ended up doing, and this is a little bit of our own technical validation on the engine and using iOS devices. And so we compared it to some, you know, high end laser scanners and set control of the total station and things in the warehouse environment. Compared, you know, three different products, like one mobile scanning product that's like interior cart scanner, high end scanner, and then more like a total station / scanner, and the results that we were seeing, like, you know, obviously with the iPhone, it's not for everything, but if you can get close to an asset, you know, you've got a 5-meter range on the LiDAR, and then a little bit more of a range with photogrammetry now that the megapixels and, you know, size of imagery just keeps getting larger. So if you can get close to the asset, we're getting similar results, but if I wanted to prove it, I would just throw a couple of ground control points in, like April tags or machine-readable tags, and use those as scale, right? But one of the nice things with the LiDAR sensor is now we get a scale point cloud out of the processing immediately.
Yeah. I see the wheels turning over here. So tell me, how does it function? Like the person out in the field who's collecting the data, whether it be pictures or whatever, does it just get uploaded into the cloud and then your user, your customer has an account, they log in and they have access to all the
information? Here's me shaking my head yes to you and not realizing I'm on a podcast. I actually have to say something. Yes. I mean, it's if you can take a picture with a phone or capture a video, you can capture 3D. That's how simple the workflow is. But in terms of what happens behind the scenes, it all gets uploaded to the cloud automatically. The reconstruction happens automatically. And then the images in the 3D point cloud end up in the portal automatically for the end user.
Got it. Super cool. Talk about the business model a little bit. Is it a subscription? Is it a purchase? How does it work?
Yeah, it's a SaaS subscription model. So there's a monthly or annual for the portal, you know, to house data and information. And then on the app side for the capture, there's a per capture cost. So, and it's pretty minimal in the grand scheme of what it costs to capture stuff. But every time, essentially, we process what's collected into 3D, there's a small fee collected for that.
And a little bit of difference between industries, right? A utility pole is going to be different than a cell tower site or a cell rooftop site.
So where are you guys in the process here? You know, you've got, obviously, several years in now. You've got something rolled out. You're trying to get more awareness, or are you really trying to spread more into different areas?
We've been in business as a business for a little bit now with the app and portal. We just launched this year.
So okay.
Revenue and, you know, starting in January with that.
How do you find, what do I just look for easy virtual capture on the app store? What do you got to do here?
Yeah, VTS 360 capture.
Okay.
And you'll find the app. You can download it. There's a free trial with it. So you can start capturing things and see what the data looks like. We're hoping to get some more awareness around the idea. You know, for us, it's we think the toolbox needs to get extended. The phone is a valid tool that we should all be using in the capture space, and it goes right alongside terrestrial scanning, drones, mobile mapping, all of those things. It's just one more tool in the toolbox.
And I really think the example of, you have this asset put together, somebody comes and bolts something else on, to be able to capture that and add it into that model, I think it just seems like it makes a lot of sense.
It's like the change management aspect of
it. Yeah, exactly. How else are you going to get that? And no, you're not going to go and rescan entire sites because, you know, normal evolution of the equipment changes.
And you might not need to capture the entire site because of that change, or the iPhone data might be good enough to understand the implications of those changes. But at least now you know about it, you have it, and then you can make that decision. Do I got to deploy something more? Because it's a big enough change that things really are different. And so now I'll take something else out to do that. Or no, yeah, hey, that's a minor change. Great, I'm aware of it. We'll just kind of swap it out, and we're good to go.
Well, actually, that was a big thing in the GIS world is data updates, right? So to me, like, this is the next generation of GIS data collection. If you are able to capture it in 3D, why not do it in 3D to give you more context about that asset, right? Even though you might be updating attributes about the, you know, condition or asset health or whatever it might be, but why not capture it in 3D if you've got the ability to?
And apparently, we all have the ability to in our pockets.
That's right.
Yeah. You're going to have to get an iPhone, though.
I'll wait for the Android update.
You're an Android guy? Oh, boy.
One of these
oh
guys.
Boy. Oh, everything boy. Was going so well, Sean.
I know. Yeah. I know. We were just really bonding, and then we just diverted.
It just went to shit.
It happens.
Can I say that?
Yes.
Yeah, it's parental advisory.
Yeah, don't worry about it.
Sorry.
So what else you guys excited about? You get some awareness. What's next with the group? What are you going to do? What else can you get any simpler?
I think probably, like, the area that we'd like to get into is probably more automation of deliverables, right? And this is an area that we've partnered in the past with, and you know, it's like utility pole extraction. And at the end of the day, generally people want some kind of line drawing, and a lot of times that's 2D block. It could just be CAD blocks that get inserted into something else, right? So it's, you know, depending on the different applications, how do we automate more of those deliverables in the different applications or the different industries that we're looking at?
I can't wait to try it out. Sounds really interesting.
I can't wait to hear what you think about it after you try it out.
Yeah. Like, for the as-built application, I think it could be gold.
I mean, it involves getting someone that's not in my company on board, but I think the benefits far outweigh what it would take to, because basically you got to go and at the pre-construction meeting, like, all right, everyone download this app. If the surveyor's not there and you're covering it up, and we can't be there for whatever reason, at least get this done. So if we have to piece it back together later, we can.
Yeah, exactly.
I love it. Great idea, guys.
Yeah.
Congrats.
Yeah, I appreciate it. And yeah, we're excited to see where it goes. And
yeah, very cool. Very cool. I feel like we could talk so much longer on this. Maybe we'll have you guys come back for a full show sometime.
Yeah, absolutely.
So that'd be a lot of fun.
Great.
BTS 360?
VTS 360 capture on the App Store.
All right.
Apple All right. only. No. Google.
I got it. I got
Play,
it. I got
Google,
it.
Whatever they call it.
Nathan, John, appreciate you guys thank stopping you guys. By.
It's been great.
Awesome. Yeah. Thanks
enjoy the rest
us.
Of the show.
Yeah, thank you very much. Appreciate
Thanks.
It.
Outro music.
Was it Stacy's mom?
Stacy's mom.
We're going to be associated with Stacy's mom now forever.
Oh, that's great.
So fun.
Hey, now you know you never listen. Sunshine, you know you're always missing out. You surprise.
Okie doke.
We're back again.
We are rolling, man. Rolling.
It's been a good day so far.
It has indeed. Talked to some amazing people. And this
really
this next guest is added to that list. I'm excited to hear his story. He's been doing laser scanning for a very, very long time. But let's start out with a self-introduction, name, who you're with, and kind of what you do.
Yeah. Thanks for having me on here, guys. This is really great. My name is Mike Falk, and I started our own company in our basement 29 years ago in 1995.
Okay.
And before that, I worked for a large company called Parsons Brinkerhoff. And the last job I had with them was a superconducting super collider outside of Dallas, Texas. And that's where I got introduced to 3D laser measurement. And we put a lot of holes in the ground and some tunnels in the ground, and the federal government canceled that job. And
oh, wow.
I had the opportunity to move to pretty much anywhere. We wanted to go with Parsons, Brinkerhoff. Mm-hmm. And instead, we chose a little engineering company for sale in Northwest Indiana. We thought we'd give it a go. And a year later, a year and a half later, we ended up starting our own company in the basement. And Jerry Garcia said, what a long, strange trip it's been.
He did.
Let's talk about that just a little bit, because we were talking before we had you jump on here about some of the early scanning technology that you were using.
Yeah.
Well, the first one I got to play with was a Cyrax 2400. Then the first one we owned was serial number 49, Cyrax 2500. And, you know, it's interesting when you talk about democratization of collecting survey data. And I can remember being a summer intern, and we'd bust our butts.
You can say it's okay.
We'd bust our butts and collect maybe 200 points in a day, where you're pulling the chain down the middle of a road and slapping 90s and measuring with a cloth tape and writing it all down in the field book. You might get 200 points. We were rock stars. And then in 82, I got to use the first electronic total station. I think the name of the company was Omni or something like that.
Omni.
And then I got to use the first GPS from Texas Instruments in
Texas Instruments.
85, wow. And the first scanner and the first tracker I used was a Chesapeake laser, which is a very early predecessor of what is now Faro Company.
Really?
And, you know, I'm just at the age where I've had the opportunity to work with some great people and use some fantastic equipment.
So I could ask the normal question of how has the equipment evolved over time, but I mean, that's, I guess I'm just curious, like, I know the biggest difference is obviously bigger, or better, smaller, faster, everything else. But what do you think has accelerated the most over, like, have you seen all this technology?
The amount of data you can collect. And I started by saying you collect 200 points in a day back in the late 70s, early 80s. The first total station, you might get 500 points in a day. Then GPS on an ATV might get 5,000 points in a day. And the first scanner was 11,000 shots a second, man. And we were rock stars.
Right.
And I can remember, if you go into the steel industry, there's things called coke batteries. They take coal and they make charcoal version of it. And it's called coke. And it used to take us 3 to 6 months to measure that the old way. And with the 2500, we did it in 3 weeks. And now with the modern technology, we typically do it in 2 days, and we could probably do it a lot quicker if the clients let us. But there's certain safety procedures. They want us to make sure that we do things very deliberately. And, sure. You know, with some of the more modern technology that we have on SLAM systems, we could probably do what we used to do in 3 to 6 months in maybe 3 hours.
Amazing. So, like, what the Cyrex scanner, what did that cost back in the day?
$178,000. Not that I recall.
That is insane. And I was just trying to pull up a picture of it so I could show Sean. It was like, how big was it?
It looks like a microwave and you're pointing it at somebody.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's awesome. So how these guys so, like, what do you remember, like, what you were charging to do scan jobs back in 95? And how much you would charge today to do the same exact scan job?
I would tell you that the same exact scan job, and this is where I kind of go sideways with a lot of surveying companies. I believe that we add a lot of value to jobs. And at Parsons Brinkerhoff, I was the only surveyor. When I ended up quitting, I was the only surveyor in the whole company. Hmm. And I showed them how much risk schedule and budget they could mitigate if they better spec bought and managed surveying services or measurement services. Because at best, surveying might be 1%, maybe 0.5% of an entire project from planning phase to design, construction, the whole bit. But one little bad shot can ruin a day.
Yep. Yeah, or a project.
Yes.
Yeah, definitely. So
what I'm going to say is we try to charge more every excuse we get.
Yeah, I like it. Makes perfect sense to me.
But what we do talk about a lot is, and I guess what I thought Kent was asking is, all right, there was one point where that job took a week. You spent $178,000 or whatever it is. It's probably not. And then the next day that took 2 days. Was it the same price, or did you give them the 2 day fee, or
the thing? We have several contracts that are T&M, and I always tell our managers, bid everything you can, lump sum. But we have some contracts that demand that we do T&M. And every time we bought a new scanner, I would come in and you know, they said, well, it's a laser scanner. The last one was a laser scanner. But no, but this one's, this dial goes all the way up to 11. Yeah, right. Do you get the reference?
Yes. Oh, my gosh. That's so funny. So point being, and I think I know where Sean's trying to get.
Yeah.
Just because we can do things faster, should we be charging less?
No.
Yeah, that's why you run lump sum, is they're not going to see the difference. And
you know, and I heard somebody say earlier today that some of the R&D that they're doing, they've got a special offline budget for it. And I don't know about you guys, but my clients pay me to be better than I was yesterday. That
sure.
We learned something, and we may have done it this way for you on the last job. That's a technician's job if you want it done the same way. Mm-hmm. If you want an engineer or a professional or a surveyor, you better expect some improvement.
Yeah. And here's what I ask. I was talking to this guy last night, definitely not going to mention any names, and he was telling me that he provides the quality, the highest quality at a price down here. He's like, my quality's up here, my price is down here. Like he was bragging about it, right? I'm like, why are you doing that? And he's like, well, if I don't charge this, somebody else will, and we won't get the work. Like, that is the most ludicrous thing I think I've ever heard in my life.
Well, I don't think it's, I agree with you. It's not the right thing necessarily, but it's not that crazy. I mean,
well, now wait a second.
He's got a business model, right? Now, it may be the volume,
I guess.
Yeah, volume, right?
Fred Flintstone had a business model.
Yeah, yeah. And he provided for his family.
Went to the quarry every day.
Wilma loved him.
Oh, that Wilma.
I mean, I guess you got to look at it as, is the quality really, really there?
I don't know.
Just because you say it is doesn't mean anything.
The quality isn't the issue. The issue is solving the client's problem. And, you know, I've given this representation at professional society meetings before. If you talk to a title insurance company guy that closes jobs for developers, he'll tell you that title insurance is about 0.1% of the project value. The realtor or the bank, the realtor's going to nab anywhere between 5% and 10%. The bank, depending on how the loan is structured, may get twice as much money. Maybe there's a balloon payment at the end and they only get 20%. And the surveyor, and then I asked the title guy and said, so everybody's price is a percentage. And it's goes up as the value of the project goes up. How about the surveyors? What do they do? He goes, at best, they've held their prices, if not gone down. And the interesting thing, if you look at a Title B on title insurance, it says this does not cover anything that wouldn't be covered by an accurate survey. And so what I asked the guy, I said, so basically you're insuring something that is in the past. It's like going into your bookie and say, I want to bet on last week's game. How about the Super Bowl? I'll take the Chiefs.
Yeah, it doesn't sound like a good bet for me. But given my recent track record, I might as well bet the past because I'm not even going to be any better.
Yeah, but I mean, it's just like surveyors are historically just horrible business people. You know, it's a race to the bottom. I mean, this guy was a young guy, and he was telling me this last night. I'm like, it's a race to the bottom. Why are you doing this to yourself? You're discrediting. It's not even a profession. Like, scanning's not a profession.
You know, in our realm, we introduced laser scanners and laser trackers into the metals industry in 1998. And because of our success, early on, we traveled all over the world doing this stuff. And it would be nothing to file taxes in 4 to 6 countries and 10 to 15 states.
Wow.
And we could charge whatever we wanted. And, you know, if you ever take your dog over to your friend's house and they have a dog, that dog spends the first hour sniffing everywhere. And it's the same way when you go into somebody else's town and do work for their clients. They sniff all over, man.
Oh, yeah.
And so we're kind of in the same place. We've always collected the data and tried to add the value of the analysis and, you know, reporting on it and making the suggestions. That's why we call ourselves a solution company. Meanwhile, a lot of the people that have left me, when they were project managers, they said, well, Mike, we got to get that job. We got to lower our prices. And I said, I tell you what, you lower your salary 10%, I'll lower my fee 10%. I never got a volunteer.
I love that. Right? That's awesome. You're going to have to use that one.
I think I will, actually.
And so are these guys that left, they forgot how important the client is. And the majority of our competition, they get a phone call, say, hey, we need somebody, a tracker crew to come out. And they say, great, there's a tracker crew, and there's a laser tracker. Hmm. Handle it. And we'll ask who, what, where, why, when. You know, hey, great, we'll come out and measure everything, what's going on. You've got quality issues, maintenance issues, throughput issues. What kind of issues do you have? And we'll try to dig in and solve that problem. And, you know, the guys that are just trying to race to the bottom have no clue about client satisfaction.
Yep. Right. Well, their job is to collect data the cheapest way possible so they can give their client something and say that they have a deliverable, I guess.
But it's not, I mean, you tell me, like, any scanning practices, methods, whatever, are there any set standards for that? Any quality standards of any type that have to be followed?
There are some, but what I'll tell you is always, always, always have survey control. You don't need to survey every target. Mm-hmm. And typically for long jobs that we do a lot of, if you imagine a building that's a half mile long and 125 feet wide, mm-hmm. We'll throw control down through the center of the building and not shoot all the targets. You know, we'll put some of the targets, the control on targets, but if you want to see a really tight closure on a point cloud, use a laser tracker for your control. It is amazing.
Huh.
I have never seen the laser scanner outperform a tracker. Interesting. And, you know, there are some scanners in here that we have consistently gotten under a millimeter when we register it with laser trackers.
Wow. Can't do much better than that.
Well, I don't even think you want to.
In some cases. Point.
Yeah, I mean, in some, especially in the machine control, you know, like when you're in the machining industry, and I'm sure you can get really, really down, but that just seems like very, very, very precise.
Yeah.
Well, in the lab, we're typically, this common standard for today in a laboratory, they're trying to get down to about 1/10,000th of an inch. Mm. But it's in a controlled environment, 72 degrees.
Right, yeah.
You'll never see a speck of dirt in your life.
It's always 72 degrees.
Yes.
It's always the same humidity.
Yes.
It's like San Diego.
Yeah, exactly.
Man, so you've seen tremendous advancement. Where do you see it going in the future? What's next?
You know, I had the conversation with a few people here, and what I would tell every young person getting into the industry, and every old person for that matter, is when you start to use a laser scanner, don't think like you're doing a topo. Think differently. Because you'll see a lot of people go in and measure something and go into the point cloud and pick out a point just like they were surveying. When you start to look at all the other data in between, and this is where our company is really pushing things. You know, for instance, 2 years ago we were here and we gave a presentation on what we're doing in mills with scanning. We were, about 10 years ago, we were challenged to figure out a way to do overhead crane rail surveys faster, safer, cheaper.
Okay.
And the biggest expense was, no matter how fast we did it, you had to shut the crane down. You had to lock out, tag out the crane. You had to do a safety inspection of the wire. And then you got your crew up on there on the rail to do the survey. Well, we figured out a way to do it without ever shutting the crane down.
Hmm.
And, you know, when you're in a facility upwards of $250,000 an hour in lost profit.
Hmm.
So it really, you know, they don't care if you're $5,000 more expensive.
Yeah, they don't care. No.
And along the way, what we figured out is we saw structural, some of these buildings are fairly old.
Right.
And we could see the structural engineers' marks up in the building where they had found cracks or loose connections. And what we found is that we could see the cracks and we could measure the cracks. We could see the effects of the cracks and the effects of the loose connections. But the really interesting part was we found out that we could see, you know, the steel just doesn't rip like a piece of paper. It warps and distorts and it cracks.
Right.
And we found out that we could see the areas of the girders, obviously where it's cracked, but also where it was warped and distorted beyond design tolerances, but no crack had been identified. Hmm. So we're taking the inspection phase from a reactive point to a proactive point. So learning actually how to use the equipment and the power of the data, that's the biggest part.
Yeah. You know, that's kind of cool.
Yeah, super cool. All right. What do you think, Chief?
I mean,
great conversation.
I got so many questions, but it's a 15-minute interview, so
ask away. You can edit it out.
Right. Actually, what you were just talking about, like that, do you have to get it from all different sides? Like, are you just, was that by chance where you just happened to see the dimension on that girder, or?
No, you know, most modeling software will go back and check the standard girder sizes and try to fit something to it. But realistically, I mean, I could show you examples where we did a case study for a client and they knew they had problems with the crane because it squeaked like crazy. And we went in and scanned it without a crane in place. And then they brought a crane in and lifted a 40,000 ton coil and we scanned it again. And on one side, the girder lost all of its camber. They went up and checked it, and they found a 30-inch crack in the web.
Wow.
And on the other side, the bottom of the girder swept in towards the center line of the bay about an inch. And they went up and checked it, and the connections to the column were loose. So, and, you know, those don't just get loose all of a sudden either. It through cycles, things start to loosen up or they crack.
Yeah.
And so if you can start to see the cycles where it's warping and it's going to cause cracking or it's going to cause loose connections. This whole idea of going up and inspecting a bridge at arm's length or looking visually for cracks, I think as a profession we can replace.
I agree. Yeah, I would not disagree with that.
Yeah.
And it just seems like we need to expand what we think we can do with the scanning technology.
So
right now or not.
When I'm with my structural engineering, and maybe I should call them colleagues and not friends, but anyways, I said, you know, guys, if you're looking for cracks, that means it's already failed. It's already past its elastic phase. It's past its plastic phase, and it's failed. Is that all you look for in life is failure?
I love that.
And there is a deformation thing before you start cracking. There's a whole realm of
butt is. Yes. Like,
there's a lot of room to see things before you get to that point.
Oh yeah, and you know, so when you use visualization to quantify cracks, you're basically using laser scanning and AI to do the same thing you did with a wheel,
right?
50 years ago.
That's correct. Just what are you going to do with all that?
And, you know, I was at a conference 2 months ago, and somebody was talking about crack quantification. And I said, so is there a precursor to cracks? He goes, well, I don't know. What are you talking about? And I said, well, you're a civil engineer. Come on. And he goes, well, what is it? And I said, have you considered that there's another way to track the life of an asset other than looking for the failure? Can you look for the wear, the partial part of it? Because even when you go up and do x-ray on a girder, they're looking for the very beginning of a crack.
Right.
But what is there before the very beginning of the crack? It's the very beginning of the distortion. Mm. Or when they look for section loss, they're looking to see if there's still enough beam to support what they need to do. Well, how about they do an estimate with actual data on what the condition of that beam is and how well it's doing?
That makes way too much sense.
Well, I mean, if the scans were cheap enough, maybe we could do it. But, you know,
I know a guy.
You know a guy. All right.
Let me repeat to you then why surveyors are such bad business people. The banker gets 50%. The realtor gets 10%. And the title insurance guy gets a 0.1% for insuring nothing.
Mm. Yeah.
For insuring yesterday.
But it's still a percentage.
Yes.
And it's always a $500 survey. Every time, regardless.
Crazy.
Well, hey, Mike, thank you. You've been great.
Hey,
it's
been fun, man. I really appreciate the opportunity.
Great to meet you.
Thanks.
Go Boilers.
here we are.
We are still
winding
here.
Winding down the day, I believe.
It is almost 5 o'clock. This it is. Like is. If the work day perfect could timing. Go through like this,
yep.
Man, life would be so much better.
You wouldn't even call it work.
You wouldn't, actually.
No. Excited to have this conversation. A couple of young guys here. Bring up the energy just a little bit, I'm
just
assuming.
A little bit, yes.
Yep. We've got Tim and Jeffrey. I'm going to let them introduce themselves. Just name who you're with and kind of what you do for your company. Go ahead.
All right. My name is Tim Ultee. I work for Parsons, AEC firm. I'm a principal GIS specialist, so cool. I help manage our GIS there. I also work in digital twins. And lastly, I help manage our drone team with Jeffrey and some of our other folks.
Awesome. Jeffrey?
Cool. Hey, everyone. My name is Jeffrey Hong. I'm the drone program manager for Parsons. I support all different kinds of operations at Parsons, whether it's on the defense side, environmental side, construction side. It's
wow.
Anything that requires drones, I'm initial so point of contact.
All of Parsons?
All of Parsons.
Wow. Good for you guys.
Thanks.
Talk about overachievers. We're just a couple of dumb podcasters.
Yeah, really. Where did you go wrong?
Oh, it's such a failure.
Right.
So what do you guys love about what you do?
Well, for me, a lot of it is the autonomy side. So, you know, growing out drone program right now, you know, we're in a relatively new industry. I mean, it's been around for a while. I've been in the industry for 11, 12 years. But just seeing, you know, the leadership at Parsons knows that this is an area that's growing very rapidly. Yep. They don't necessarily need to, you know, be overheads every day trying to make sure we're doing things perhaps in whatever way that they might imagine. They give us the freedom and autonomy to go out and
awesome.
Do our own things.
Very cool. Very cool. Tim, you mentioned digital twins. Mm-hmm. Talk about that a little bit.
So I've worked on some airport digital twin projects, also kind of adjacently helped with some kind of more city level type of you know, work where we're trying to manage assets better. And one of the parts I like about that, kind of tying into what Jeffrey said, is that digital twins and a lot of these various specialties are coming together. So, you know, I might have started from a GIS base, that's my background.
Yeah.
But, you know, you bring in drones, well, now you're capturing data you can use in GIS. You know, now you're looking at digital twins where you're also managing assets and doing predictive analytics on the stuff. You're bringing GIS into that because that's where a lot of that data comes from, along with BIM and other sources. So it's really kind of this, it's more about bringing these disparate sections together and these different softwares together more than it is about like some brand new thing that has never existed. Just using stuff better.
So when you're building these digital twins, are they for like your internal clients, or are they for your external clients, or both?
External clients. I mean, we're an AEC firm, so we're not really, you know, other than just doing cool stuff to present to others, we're generally doing stuff like we're following our clients, and we're trying to lead our clients in ways, but we're doing it in a way that's going to value them. So, you know, Parsons isn't really building models just for the sake of it for our own kind of fun, even though that's cool. You know, we're doing it because an airport really wants to build a digital twin of their terminal or of their runway or of their utility assets. You know, and that's where we're going with that.
So, Jeffrey, in your case, what are some of the biggest challenges you face on a daily basis?
Well, I'd say, you know, in most organizations, especially like Parsons size, 18,000 plus employees, you know, there's a lot of silos different areas.
Sure.
So the biggest part in my role that I've been able to help out with in terms of challenges is breaking down a lot of the silos, getting a lot of the teams to have mutual resources to work on the same projects, especially like one of the ones with like some of the folks that you guys met earlier. It's getting like our geophysics team. Normally they find bombs. We use a team that finds bombs with, you know, geophysical classification, tie in with the environmental team that normally just goes and digs for oil wells and does it, or, you know, digs to do a remediation of orphan wells.
Sure.
And tie in like our drone teams, our GIS teams, bring everyone together onto the same page. So that's like, you know, a challenge that we've taken and you know, built it into more of a collaborative, what we call it, a one Parsons solution, where it brings all our teams together.
Okay. Would you want to be on the bomb finding team? Is that something that's interesting to you?
Am I flying the drone to find it, or am
you're walking. You just walk around.
You know, my skill set could be used in such better areas.
Man. What do you love about working at Parsons?
I love that it's really broad, is that you can kind of create your own career at Parsons. Like, usually when you start out at a company, you're just kind of like, you're maybe on one project, you're brought in to do one thing. But, you know, I've been there about 8 years now, and you can pretty quickly, it's a big enough company that you're like, oh, you want to get into digital twins? You can do that. You want to help start our drone team, you know, with cool people like Jeffrey? You can do that. You know, and so you can kind of bring whatever skill set you want you know, you find the client that does it. You know, somewhere, we're not the biggest company. We're big enough where someone somewhere at Parsons is probably doing the thing that you're interested in. Or at least you can find someone with a client who is interested in it, and then you can be the one who starts it.
Sure.
So Jeffrey, besides coming to, like, you know, shows like this, how do you keep up with emerging technology?
Lots of industry contacts, so friends, sometimes on LinkedIn, sometimes, you know, a lot of times, you know, real life friendships, just keeping in touch with different folks in all different industries. You know, a lot of these things all tie back in together, whether it's pulling in things that teams are doing on the public safety side, or if it's teams that are doing things on unexploded ordnance geophysics side. You know, just knowing everyone, bringing together similar technologies and people are doing similar things despite being in different industries, and taking that knowledge and, you know, distributing it back out.
Yeah. So I'm curious, you know, being in a place like this, talk a little bit about where the technology is going. I mean, you know, we're just a couple of podcast surveyor and engineer guys up here, but is it just getting bigger and having bigger payloads, or where's the cool technology trend here?
Well, so from our end, I would say the payloads are certainly improving, right? Like size, weight, and power of all your different payloads are you know, becoming smaller. There's more powerful payloads that we can start using. So part of it is seeing increased different kinds of applications, like unique applications. Other side is seeing how the policies and regulations are changing out different kinds of things, whether that's, you know, trying to use more more domestically manufactured unmanned aircraft or payload and sensors, or if it's, you know, depending on, like, you know, we operate in the U.S. and Canada, or whether it's, you know, you continue to use some of the things that we've used in the past just with, you know, different kinds of costs and capabilities.
Hmm. So in your guys' opinion, what role should the land surveyor play in this kind of data capture? Will it be drones?
Such a softball question.
Yeah. Well, I mean, also a very dangerous one here at this conference.
Right? Be careful.
I've heard some of the conflict. No, I mean, I think there's a lot of space for both sides of it. You know, I think Micah earlier from Esri said it best, where he said there's certain things that you absolutely need a land surveyor for. You know, I have very little interest in doing a drone flight to build a model of the foundation of a hospital that they're going to put, you know, 10,000 people in. Like, that's right. Not my job, you know, but someone comes to us and says, hey, I just want a 3D model of this building so that I can use it for presentations. Or I want a 3D model of this slope so that I can kind of, like, understand what I'm even working with before I even get to a land surveyor. And so, you know, and I think it was also said well in some of the presentations here that there's just, we have a lack of resources, a lack of people. So the more tools you can put in other people's hands to at least get the process started, but I think you still have those land surveyors there to kind of act as the experts in the room, as the adults in the room, and say, hey guys, you can't just walk around with a handheld unit and think you're going to solve all your problems. Like, do you know anything about control? Do you know anything about your absolute accuracy? Like, that's not, there's still a very good place for land surveyors, I think, in that industry.
My takeaway is land surveyors are the adult in the room. That's my takeaway from that.
Okay.
Let's not forget that.
I'll give it to you.
Well, I mean, because everyone just wants to throw out, like, oh, Google, solve everything. And, like, these, you know, tech companies are awesome, but their slogan literally was move fast and break things. And right. You can't break things when it's a bridge. You know, so there is a purpose to having the adults in the room. Even if you bring the young techie people to come in to say, hey, we can use drones for that. That's fantastic. And you sometimes you have to drag the adults in the room along with the children and be like, look at this cool stuff. You should care about this. You should use a drone. But then you still need the adults to say, okay, but I'm still going to verify that. Like, I'm still going to trust and verify that. And once I verify that that's accurate, then I'll start using it too. And it'll be
right.
Great.
And one thing we see a lot of is what the intent of that drone or that data in the beginning may not be the same by the time someone else gets it. And you can easily start here, and by the time you get to the end, probably should have had somebody check to see if that... Because who know, you know, and I guess the person down at the end doesn't know that the original person that collected the data didn't do it yet.
Yeah, and that was discussed in some of the sessions here too. And I think very well put to say, like, look, I just made a pretty model. It's not accurate at all, and you shouldn't expect it to be so. But then five runs down the line, they don't know that.
That's in a slope stability analysis report, and they're dimensioning off a snapshot of that same model. That I can see that too.
Yeah, metadata. Populate your metadata.
I love that. Well, of course, the digital twin guy is going to say that, right?
100%. So, Jeffrey, what was I going to ask you? I had the best question, and I lost it. I got it. What role is artificial intelligence playing in your world?
In my world, so a lot of stuff, you know, we deal with is data, right? So like, as you know, basically, you know, at the end of the day, we're drone service providers, internal drone service providers, you know, and so what matters at the most at the end of the day is the data. So, you know, we've been testing different kinds of methods for, you know, doing like, let's say, computer vision stuff, whether it's trying to count animals with thermal, doing like biodiversity kind of survey kind of work, or if it's counting cars, doing traffic analysis kind of stuff. So, you know, we've been utilizing AI of sorts, you know, in different areas, you know. A lot of it is plug and play, like, you know, a lot of people, or not plug and play, you know, it's a bad data in, bad data out kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But, you know, as this technology is growing, you know, it's obviously we're seeing more and more use cases. And a lot of it is, you know, trial error learning, seeing how we can just optimize our efficiency maybe by just a little bit, right? It might not be that we're going to be able to extract everything that we need with the data, but if we can clean it up a bit, how does that increase our work or increase our efficiency and make our workflow just a little bit better?
Yep.
Good stuff.
So what are you guys excited about? What's the most exciting thing you've seen around here so far?
Sure. Yeah. So the, you know, it's been cool to meet some of the people who've been doing like the Nerf sub neurons ratings field kind of stuff, you know, in person. They, you know, following a lot of that stuff on LinkedIn over the past, say, a year or so. Yeah. And, you know, it's, you know, we all know where photogrammetry has its place, but, you know, just seeing how amazing the modeling features of Nerf is,
yep.
Is pretty neat. And just meeting the people face-to-face, it's, you know, who knows where it's going to go in a year? Will we be able to actually measure things off of what we're producing with different kinds of technologies?
Yeah.
Do you follow Michael Gula?
I do.
He's a rock star.
2D is against his religion.
2D is against his religion. He knows.
Love that guy. Love that guy. How about you, Tim?
I think I'd tandem on that with some of the developments both in photogrammetry and LiDAR is both that, you know, we've been using photogrammetry for a long time just because LiDAR had such a high price point. You know, and so, yes, some people are absolutely using it, but for someone who's like, I just want my 20-acre site, like, you know, they say, I want LiDAR, and they tell them the price, and they go, never mind. You know,
but it's only 20 acres.
Yeah, like, yeah, no, thank you. But, you know, seeing the price point come down on some of those, and then also some of the processing I've seen here, like, demonstrated, you know, the amount of pain that you go through, both the surveyors and just this, us just making pretty models sometimes.
Right.
Of like, hey, can I pretend that car's not there? It's like, you know, that's actually really difficult. You know, as soon as they say, oh, I want to pretend this site has topographic contours, but with no buildings on it. And that sounds like a relatively simple thing. Maybe it's kind of like the nerd part of me. They're like, oh, this is the exciting thing. Where it's like, it shouldn't be, but it kind of is to me because I've lived the life of like trying to remove buildings that turn into pyramids, or especially like tanks.
A tank farm,
and they just turn into these cones. You know, and it's like, it's just so labor intensive to turn that into something that like looks nice and is usable to a client. And seeing, like, you know, DJI and some of the other providers just come out and be like, hey, look, select it, and it's gone. You know, and it's like, I'm not saying, I haven't tested it yet myself, so I'm not saying it's there already, but, like, already that looks really promising to me to just make our lives, like, the faster we can do things, the more we can do. And so I'm excited to see a lot of those efficiencies.
Yeah.
Well, and especially the faster you can do the remove the building part of it, is then allows you to do a lot more in the more of the fun stuff.
Yeah, I mean, that's less time cleaning point clouds.
Yeah, it's a good way to look at it.
Yeah, you know, it's really cool seeing companies like Esri, for example. Like, they just released their, you type in what you want to classify or remove. You're like, hey, I want to count the cars in here. You know, and you can go and classify things or count cars.
So you're not even picking from a menu anymore. Yeah. It's just you enter whatever you think and.
Yeah. You know, and you know, the technology is constantly improving. You know, I feel like everyone in the industry now is on board understanding where we can leverage this kind of technology and use cases, and
sure.
It's going to continue to grow.
Well, I'll tell you what, Tim, Jeffrey, really enjoyed this conversation. It was awesome. And you know what? The future is bright.
I
would like to leave it at that.
I think you're exactly correct.
Yeah. Yep. Thanks, guys. Appreciate your time.
Appreciate you stopping by. Enjoy the rest of the week.
Thanks for having us.
Sunshine, you know you're always missing out. You're so proud, everybody wants you now. Hey, now you know you never listen. Sunshine, you know you're always missing out. You're so proud.